Father in heaven, I thank you that we can be here together this morning, that we can have fellowship one with another, and especially with you, Father, help us to surrender our hearts to you. We pray that we will have thoughts only of love and mercy toward each other, and we pray that we'll reach out to our neighbors, and we pray that you will bless us this morning. Bless me, Father, and help the words that come out this morning to be your words and your thoughts. And as we have this health talk, we pray that we'll all be benefited by it, Father. And we pray that you'll guide my tongue, Father. Help me to be an eloquent speaker, not for pride's sake, but I pray that your word will be brought out clearly, Father. I pray in Jesus' name, your will be done. Amen. This is our first health lecture this morning. And I ask your forgiveness. I was going to have some slides, but I had some trouble. We'll continue without them. But this morning I wanted to talk about the most important organ in our body, and it houses our pneuma. Yeah, that's right, the brain.
Not much without
the brain. And without our brain, we couldn't breathe or pump blood. We couldn't see or move or hear. And most importantly, we couldn't think. While our hearts, which pump blood, and our lungs, which exchange air, are very important, such that without them we would die. Without the brain, none of that would even work. We can look at the brain as being divided into two portions functionally, the higher functions and the lower functions. The higher functions would be the portion we call the frontal lobe, and the rest of the brain portions would thereby constitute as being the lower functions. The frontal lobe is our reasoning center, is associated with such functions as personality, judgment, and self-control. The lower functions involve various parts of the brain, such as the hypothalamus, which is the part of the brain which controls hunger and appetite. The hypothalamus is a section of the brain which is responsible for hormone production. And the hormones produced in this area of the brain govern body temperature, thirst, hunger, sleep, and our moods. Then we have the visual cortex, which is located at the back of the head, which is responsible for the brain being able to process shapes, colors, and track movements. The cerebellum, which gives us our motor skill. None of us would be able to walk very well without the cerebellum. We wouldn't be able to put the food to our mouths that I'm sure that an hour we'll all be desiring. And I don't want to go too far into all the different parts of the brain this morning, but comparing the frontal lobe with the rest of the brain is basically what I want to talk about, as well as looking at the eight laws of health in the brain. And we'll start with nutrition, since we were having our New Start outreach the other day. It's a good place to start. It's important to understand that the body needs sustenance, and it needs energy. The same obviously is true of the brain, and it's part of the body. At one time it was thought that carbohydrates were the fuel of the brain, but it's actually glucose, which is a sugar. The important food source is omega-3 unsaturated fatty acids. They're found in mainly things such as flaxseed, olive oil, and nuts. Exercise is something that we want to look at and the fact that exercise improves the physical health is so well known as to be a platitude. Decades of research demonstrate that regular exercise lowers the risk of many illnesses, such as heart disease, obesity, diabetes, cancer, and extends the average lifespan. In contrast, the benefits of exercise for mental health are not quite so obvious or well publicized. It appears to combat depression in a number of ways by strengthening our biochemical resilience to stress, and countering the growth of new brain cells, bolstering self-esteem, and possibly even counterbalancing an underlying genetic risk for mental illness. It's very important that we all exercise and we get out and enjoy fresh air. It's important for our mental health, and we can't function spiritually if we're not taking care of our mental health. Psychologists and clinics have studied exercise as an alternate treatment for over 30 years. Blumenthal was one of the pioneers. In the 1980s, while studying how exercise helps patients with cardiovascular disease, he and his colleagues noticed an advert benefit, working out what seemed to be an improvement in people's moods and a reduction of symptoms of depression. They decided to investigate. One of their early studies, published in 1999, tracked the health of 156 elderly men and women diagnosed with depression as they exercised regularly or took antidepressants, or both. So these were different groups. After 16 weeks, all three groups had improved equally, but relapse rates were lowest among patients who exercised. So we can see a certain temporal or temporary benefit of taking drugs, but it's taking care of ourselves and using the methods that God has given us that will have a long-lasting effect. There are several other studies that show that exercise is highly beneficial to overcoming depression. And I know from my own personal experience that I find it very helpful. I don't know what sort of history all of you have had, but in my family there's been a long line of mental illness and depression. The depression actually stems from one side of the family, and the other side has a genetic gene that's defective. And water, and I brought some with me. It's important to mention that our waters are 77% to 78% water. And it's very important. We need to flush out our toxins. It also activates the cells. When we begin to become dehydrated, there are some interesting changes that occur in the brain. In fact, one of them is depression. In women, there is a more profound drop in mood. In other words, like I said, more depression. And so it's important to take this. So water is another treatment that we can use. In a study performed at King's College London, it was determined that as a result of dehydration, the test group's brains had to work harder to function normally at core studies. And of course, energy that could have been expelled elsewhere was wasted. And when we go about our daily lives, we want to make certain that we conserve what we can and use up where it is needed. And of course, I'm going kind of quickly through some of these because some of these I've done more research into. I find them very enlightening. Sunshine, I thought, was very interesting. And in connection with the brain, it seems to reduce depression also, encourage brain cell growth. Brain-derived neurotropic factor, also known as BDNF, I don't know if anyone's heard of that, is a protein that in humans is encoded by the BDNF gene, is a member of the neurotropin family of growth factors, which are related to the canonical nerve growth factor. In fact, some people have been creating supplements to artificially increase the growth of these type of hormones and proteins in the brain. And it's interesting that some of these things that they're coming out with, you can actually create by fasting, by juicing, eating a raw food diet. But of course, society is trying to utilize an artificial. They want the magic pill, as it were.
Shorter, faster.
Early in life, the BDNF regulates not only the growth of brain cells, but also their ability to make connections to other brain cells, a process fundamental to our ability to create a more powerful brain. But keep in mind that the process of growing new brain cells, or neurogenesis, continues throughout your entire life.
Yeah.
And that's something important to think about. As you are reading this report, now I'm reading part of a quote here, your brain is actively producing new brain cells, and brain cells are always busy creating new connections with their neighboring in process. Neuroplasticity, and this is very interesting, and it's very important, because God tells us to repent and to turn away from our sins. If our brains were set, we cannot do this. And we can repent, and we can turn aside, and we can obey. But we have to develop new habits. We create new neural patterns in our brains each time. In fact, just learning something new, you've created a new path, and you can exercise that path and make it a part of you. And when we're developing our characters, when we get up in the morning, what do we do? What's the first thing that you do in the morning? Is it a habit?
Right.
It's a very good thing to do. But you can create it, a habit. It becomes recorded in your brain. So there's an actual physical property. We're not set. We're not destined by simply chemicals. But we can make choices that alter our chemicals in our brains. There are a lot of scientists who say that we don't have free will, but our brains purely govern what we do. But it is true that our brains do influence us. We can become influenced by narcotics and excitotoxins, and it will influence our ability to, when we eat, we'll feel an impulse to eat more than we should, or eat what we shouldn't. Neurogenesis and neuroplasticity, directly enhanced by the BDNF, these are things... sorry, I read the wrong part here. It says, as you are both these events directly enhanced by this property. We don't want more brain cells than we want. I'm sorry. I spilled some water in here earlier. Both of these events, neurogenesis and neuroplasticity, are directed and enhanced by the BDNF. And who wouldn't want more brain cells than are more connected? And we want them to be more connected, more readily available to make those decisions. No doubt you are now wondering what you can do to get a hold of this magic elixir that builds a better brain. But while BDNF isn't something you can buy at the pharmacy, The good news is that you can absolutely increase your body's ability to create this powerful protein and pave the way for a healthier, more resilient brain. It turns out that sunlight itself is a powerful way to increase this. Leiden University in the Netherlands, a profound seasonal variation in blood level was observed there in increasing amounts found in the blood during months with the most sunshine. As Sister Ford here?
No.
I guess not. She has trouble with her mood swings. She feels depressed in the wintertime, and this is an explanation for it. I don't know if anyone else here has this problem. But there's an alteration in the substance, the BDNF, with the loss of sunlight in the winter. This information has important implications. Not only does it offer up yet and explain why individuals may become depressed in winter months, but in living in places with little sunshine. And of course, here in West Virginia in the Hollow, sometimes it's very little sunshine. Like many, I know I battle sometimes depression myself, like I said. So exercising, drinking water, and sunshine, and these are all things that benefit me. And sometimes I don't get them, and it affects me very greatly. Temperance is next on the list, and speaking of an experiment, that rats given access to high-fat foods showed some of the same characteristics as animals hooked on cocaine or heroin, and found it hard to quit even when given electroshocks. Like many people, rats are happy to gorge themselves on tasty, high-fat treats. Bacon, sausage, hopefully we've given up those, chocolate, and even cheesecake, which became favorites in laboratory rats that recently were given access to these human indulgences, so much so that the animals became dependent on high quantities to feel good, like drug users who need to up their intake and get high. And when I read Sister White's writings, and she talks about the use of stimulants and the use of spices and foods and things and how they're used too much. We went on a special diet, a bland diet when we were younger, and we just used crushed tomatoes on top of spaghetti and things like that. And I remember eating some ragu after doing that for probably a few years, and it tasted so spicy, it burnt my throat. And it just made me realize, you know, how true that is. That we use too many condiments, too many seasonings. Particularly in the world, I know a lot of us are using more herbs and things that are more simple. Things that go to accordance to what God has revealed. A new study published March 28th in Nature Neuroscience describes these rats' indulgence. It says, adding to research literature on how excess food intake can trigger changes in the brain, alterations that seem to create neurochemical dependency in the eater or user. It's a part. Primary findings from the work were presented at the Society for Neuroscience meeting in 2009. And it's amazing to me how many different studies have come out. There's some that were back in the 70s, not necessarily on this subject, but there's a lot of information. It's amazing to me that in the mainstream, you know, in the food industry, of course, that's a moneymaker, and in the health industry, people are just overlooking all this information, and people are dying. And we should be able to share this with other people. And it was really great being to be out the other day and other days. I know sometimes I go out shopping and I pick things from the organic produce section. People, I remember this young man came up to me and said, like, why are you, what's the deal with organic? You know, why are you picking this out? And I told him, well, you know, it's really hard to get pesticide off of food. Also, it's supposed to be non-GMO. And I explained to him what a GMO was. It had a virus that was tagged on to the genes of something else and inserted into other genes. And that was very unstable. And that was a witness to him. He went away satisfied with an explanation. And, you know, these are ways that we can reach out to people and help them. And hopefully we can share the Three Angels' messages with them. Like many pleasurable behaviors, including intimacy or drug use, eating can trigger the release of dopamine, a feel-good neurotransmitter in the brain. And this internal chemical reward, in turn, increases the likelihood that the association with the action will eventually become habitual throughout positive reinforcement conditioning. If activated by overeating, these neurochemical patterns can make the behavior tough to shake. In other words, we're talking about an addiction. A result seen in many human cases. Most people are overweight, one would say, and quoting a doctor here, I would like to control my weight and my eating, but they find it very hard to control their feeding behavior. This is very, very common. It's a battle, and it's a very tough uphill battle. But we have God on our side, and we can ask Him each day to help us to overcome. Despite a growing body of research, it has been unclear whether extreme overeating is initiated by a chemical irregularity in the brain, or if its behavior itself is changing the body's biochemical makeup. And this is by a conclusion by the Netherlands, here, the college I mentioned. The new research by Kenny and his colleague Paul Johnson, a graduate student, shows that both conditions are possible. But we see that there is an influence here. We are compelled. We can eat simple things and become addicted to those things. Salt and oil are more natural. Oil isn't really the most natural. It's been eliminated from its whole food. Good morning. And so when we take that into account, we have this addiction. But then you have certain chemicals that are already in the food. They're placed there. When we eat, say, a ho-ho or a candy bar, there are certain chemicals there that will affect our brain in return. And so both can be true. It's a cycle that we can create. Despite a growing body of research, it has been unclear whether extreme overeating was initiated by a chemical... I'm sorry, I think I reread. In a 2001 study, The Lancet observed a similar dearth of dopamine receptors in the brains of many of these people, as in those hooked on cocaine and alcohol. The new research adds a more enunciated an understanding of just how food can modify the brain and shows that differences in the brain from the outset can predispose an individual for overeating. Engineering an overeater, and this comes from Scientific America, this article, says to start an addictive cycle, dopamine must be felt. And for that, the brain must have an ample dopamine receptor. And many substance abusers, a low level of dopamine receptors, either from the outset or caused by the behavior, means they increasingly have to seek more dopamine-inducing substances to seek a level of neurochemical reward they can enjoy. So once again, we're talking about addiction. After someone dependent on a substance stops using it, however, it often takes time for depleted dopamine receptors to return to baseline levels. For mice addicted to cocaine, it can take 2 days to regain normalized levels. The obese rats in the new study that they did, it took 2 weeks to regain their baseline dependency from receptors. And that's eating human food, junk food. So it took them a lot longer to overcome eating food than it did from the drugs themselves. To gauge just how much of the quantity of dopamine receptors had affected the rat's eating behavior, Kenny and Johnson inserted a virus into the brains of a test group of the animals to knock out their dopamine D2 receptors, which are known in humans to be at low levels in many substance abusers. They found that rather than gradually increasing rat brain reward thresholds in accompanying overeating behavior, these rats almost immediately had higher thresholds and took to overeating immediately when given access to high-fat diets. This connection, Kenny says, shows that for people who have lower levels of D2 receptors, it could predispose you to developing this kind of habitual behavior. So it's a very strong, very enticing thing, the foods that are around these days. Animal research shows that diets high in saturated fats leads to animals' underperformance on tests of memory and tests of reinforcing rewards. In other words, pushing a button to get food. Similar effects are highly likely in human reductions in fats and empty calories and will improve memory and brain function. In other words, if we were to reduce our calorie intake, but keep our nutrients the same level, then we would greatly benefit. This is a type of fast. Will improve our memory and brain function. A new insight is that the addiction and obesity are linked together. High fat, high calorie diets decrease the responsiveness of the brain's pleasure centers. Changes in brain chemistry involving dopamine and opioids leads to compulsive eating patterns. 65 years of animal testing shows that the rate of degenerative disease is slowed by caloric restriction, which means a balanced reduction of protein, fat, and carbs without nutrient reduction, which is repeating for what I said. And so this is very important. We should understand this aspect of nutrition. Air and breathing air is very important for our brains, and this will be another brief one. Science shows that you really should stop and smell the roses, as the smell of them promotes relaxation. And other flowers like lavender and jasmine can also lower anxiety and bring up your mood. Research shows that the scent of pine trees decreases stress and increases relaxation. Even walking through a park or your own backyard can help you feel calmer and happier. When you catch a whiff of freshly cut grass, while the rain may put a damper on your outdoor plans, we love nothing more than the scent of downpour. According to the Smithsonian magazine, the smell reminds us of color green and may be linked with the growth of both plants and animals that we need to eat, which could explain why it smells so good to us. And so here we're seeing something being compounded. You're seeing exercise, and where is that exercise? Outdoors. And what should you bring with you?
Water.
So we're talking about a great benefit to overcoming depression is mentioned a lot in a lot of the things I was looking at. Rest is very important. Increases our cognitive function. Consolidation is the fixing of memories that occurs whether we're awake or asleep. Enhancement, which is improving upon what you have learned, occurs during sleep. Thank you. It's what's called an offline effect. And so when we do something, we're learning something, we have to stop and we have to rest our brains. And then we'll learn it better. Our brains will have a chance to assimilate it. This is the practical implications. You must improve your learning by scheduling sleep. The initial become tongue-tied when my mouth is dry. The initial consolidation of something new takes about 6 hours. So don't take up a new activity within the same framework. Sleep on what you've learned, and your circuits will be refreshed. An exercise that you can do to demonstrate how your brain needs time to rest, and you can overuse your brain, is if you pick a word, you say it over and over and over again. Might be helpful if it's more than one syllable. And I'm not trying to teach you to go into a trance or anything. But when you say it, at a certain point, you'll stop and say, how is that even a word? It'll be alien to you. It's because you're overstimulating the neurons in your brain. The connections become overstimulated, and all of a sudden, your brain, it's like an extremely miniature seizure, I guess it's not really, but or epilepsy. I'm trying to think of how to compare it to. What's that?
I'm satiated.
Being full. A power nap is nearly as powerful a skill memory enhancer as a night's sleep. And so what you want to do is you don't want to go into REM sleep. What you want to do is schedule maybe half an hour at most and have a nap. And if what happens is if you go past that, you'll start going into a deep sleep. And if you wake up in the middle of that, you'll disturb the nap and it won't be a benefit to you. You'll wake up groggy. And so I used to do this. I learned early on when I was in school. I'd set my watch for 12 minutes and I'd start nodding off. And then my watch would go off and then I'd set for another 12 minutes. But apparently I could have done it longer than that. But it increases, it says finger dexterity increases 16% after a nap. And so there's nothing wrong with taking a break, taking a nap, a time out, if you feel tired. I probably need to take a couple myself. But learning to improve after a nap, the learning of facts, concepts, and general creativity will also improve. So we have to have, we can train ourselves to do this regularly, to, if we need that. I know Granny Ann sometimes goes in the afternoon and she takes a nap. There's nothing wrong with doing that, but if you nap too long, then you'll affect your night's sleep, and you'll be up half the night. And that's bad. It's not good for your brain. And trust in God. As Christians, we should be concerned with keeping our lower functions or passions under self-control, under control of the higher brain functions, which themselves should be under the control of God. And this is really what it's all about. We have all these different functions, but we want them to be seated under our frontal lobe, under our reasoning. As I stated before in the beginning, know, we have self-control and judgment and our personality. These are all in the frontal lobe. We need to make certain that we maintain and have a healthy frontal lobe. We don't want our animal propensities to take over and govern. We don't, and this is what the plasticity of the brain, what's so important, understanding it, because we can train our brains to immediately revert back to the lower passions if we allow our emotions to guide us instead of reason. Our emotions can be a sort of minor guide. We should keep them under control and subdue. They can be a window to understanding. We should be able to have compassion on people. We should be able to love people, but love, firstly, is a principle of the Bible. We should care for them. We should be able to feed them and nurture. And the emotional love we feel, it's a passing thing. It could be called vanity in a way, but having those lovely emotions can help us, and we should train them. We should be in control. We should have emotional intellect. We should be governing our passions. And as Romans chapter 12 in verse 1, Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and verse 2 says, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. And so, renewing of the mind, we're talking about repentance. Again, these are synonyms. Turning around, we can go from being on one path, one narrow path in our brain, we can start switching it to the next one, the one that God wants us to have. If we read our Bible, if we understand what it's saying, it's why it's important to know the three angels' messages, especially, you know, who God is, and He is a God of love. And if we look at the example that Jesus gave, and we can follow that pattern, and we can develop it in our brains.
Amen.
And this is very important, but we won't be able to comprehend truth, we won't be able to reason, we won't be able to rationalize if we're not taking care of our brains. If we're hooked on foods, if we're depressed all the time, we won't feel like reading our Bibles, we won't reach out to other people. All these things are interrelated to each other. Reading from Sister White, she says, there is but little moral power in the professed Christian world. Wrong habits have been indulged, and physical and moral laws have been disregarded until the general standard of virtue and piety is exceedingly low. Habits which lower the standard of physical health enfeeble mental and moral strength. The indulgence of unnatural appetites and passions has a controlling influence upon the nerves of the brain. The animal organs are strengthened, while the moral are depressed. It is impossible for the intemperate man to be a Christian, for his higher powers are brought into slavery to the passions. The artificial hair, and this is another quote, the artificial hair and pads covering the base of the brain heat and excite the spinal nerves centering in the brain. The head should ever be kept cool, excuse me. The heat caused by these artificial coverings induces the blood to the brain. The action of the blood upon the lower or animal organs of the brain causes unnatural activity that tends to recklessness in mortals, and in the mind and heart are in danger of being corrupted. And this is why I didn't want to go too far into the individual little parts of the brain, because I want to emphasize the frontal lobe versus the lower passions. That when you look at the animals, they have a lot of the same parts of the brain that we do, but we have a much greater frontal lobe capacity. God has created us so that we can reason and so that we should be able to keep those lower functions under control. We have, because of the sin of Adam and Eve, there's propensity that has been brought in because man was created perfect. You know, God, he's a designer. He used the same plan. You know, you look at the forearm, we have two bones, and the radius and the ulnar, and you go look at animals, and the evolutionists will say, see, that's proof. Man evolved from the whale or whatever, from the monkey. All these things have the same bones, but it's proof to me that it's the same designer. And it come, and when we look at the design of the brain, we see the same thing. We see the same designs, and the same lower the emotions and the hypothalamus, the desires to eat. We don't want to be lowered to our lower base passions. They're instincts. They're things that yes, it's good to be hungry because then you'll know that you need to eat, but there are times maybe when you shouldn't eat.
Amen. That's true.
The habits of the age are serious obstacles to the perfecting of human character. Physically, we are composed of what we eat, and our minds are greatly influenced by our bodies. If we subsist largely upon the flesh of animals, the animal nature is increased in like proportion. Man is sufficiently animal in his nature without cultivating those propensities by the eating of food which stimulates and excites the animal organs to activity. As these propensities are strengthened, the mental and moral powers are diminished. God did not withhold meat from the Hebrews in the wilderness simply to show his authority, but for their good, that they might preserve physical and moral strength. He knew that the use of animal food strengthens the animal passions and enfeebles the intellect. He knew that the gratification of the appetite of the Hebrews for flesh meats would weaken their moral powers and induce such an irritable disposition that the vast army would become insubordinate, that they would lose their high sense of their moral obligations and refuse to be controlled by the wise laws of Jehovah. Violence and rebellion would exist among them, making it impossible for them to be pure and happy people in the land of Canaan. God knew what was best for the children of Israel. Therefore, he deprived them in a great measure of flesh meats. And you can see that if you go through the Bible, you'll see that God was trying to lead them away from meat. Satan tempted them to consider this unjust and cruel. He caused them to lust for forbidden things. And this is what he does today to us. When we walk into the store and almost every single thing has how many ingredients in it, and how many of those things can we pronounce when we read it? Unless we've been trained, we train ourselves. We shouldn't crave those things. We should flee as a bird to the mountain. And because he saw that through the indulgence of perverted appetite, they would become carnally minded and would be easily brought to his will, the lower organs would be strengthened, while the intellectual and moral powers would be weakened. And so this is what Paul talks about when he talks about the flesh, the lust of the flesh thereof, gratifying them. He says he puts them under himself. It's a discipline. Mm-hmm. But God can help us doing that. Satan is no novice in the business of destroying souls. He well knows that if he can lead men and women into strong habits of eating and drinking, he has gained, in a great degree, the control of their minds and baser passions. In the beginning, man ate of the fruits of the earth, but sin brought into use the flesh of dead animals as food. This diet works directly against the spirit of true refinement and moral purity. The substance of which is taken into the stomach passes into the circulation and is converted into flesh and food, flesh and blood, excuse me. So it becomes a part of us. Free will is not an illusion, as some scientists have said. When God bids us obey him, we can count on him to enable us.
Amen.
He, God, has told us to repent and to forsake our sins. To repent means to turn around, and we should keep that in our always in our minds. It doesn't simply mean to turn to God one day and then go out and sin the next. Do we want to Do we want clean hearts, renewed spirits within us? That's the question that we should ask ourselves. Then we must trust God. Our minds are not wholly set. We can reprogram them. Neuroplasticity is a very real thing. It means that we can leave the wrong path and turn to the right path. In Acts of the Apostles, page 467, Sister White says, "He whose heart is fixed to serve God will find opportunity to witness for him. Difficulties will be powerless to hinder him who is determined to seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. In the strength gained by prayer and study of the word, he will seek virtue and forsake vice.
Amen.
Looking to the believer will willingly, the author and finisher of the faith, who endured the contradiction of sinners against himself, the believer will willingly brave contempt and derision. Are we willing to do that? And help and grace sufficient for every circumstance, for promising by him whose word is true, his everlasting arms encircle the soul that turns to him for aid. In his care we may rest safely, saying, what time I am afraid, I will trust in thee.
Amen.
To all who put their trust in him, God will fulfill his promise. We must trust and obey. By his own example, the Savior has shown that his powers can be in the world and yet not of the world. He came not to partake of its delusive pleasures, to be swayed by its customs or to follow its practices, but to do his Father's will. And we should do the same. To seek and to save the lost. With this object before him, the Christian may stand uncontaminated in any surroundings. Whatever his station or circumstances, exalted or humble, he will manifest the power of true religion in the faithful performance of duty.
Amen.
Not in freedom from trial, but in the midst of it, this Christian character developed. That's important. Exposure to rebuffs and opposition leads to the follower of Christ to greater watchfulness and more earnest prayer to the mighty helper. Severe trial endured by the grace of God develops patience, vigilance, fortitude, and a deep and abiding trust in God. It is a triumph of the Christian faith that it enables its followers to suffer and to be strong, to submit and thus to conquer, to be killed all the day long and yet to live, to bear the cross and thus to win the crown of glory. And it's certainly my struggle, and I'm sure we all struggle. Yes?
Just want to add something, Mike, having to do with the brain. I was listening to a Dr. Markham down in Chattanooga. He's a cardiologist. And if you have a heart attack, it destroys about 10% of your brain function. I've experienced that in my own life, especially in the memory area. And I was thinking, you know, have you ever heard of silent heart attacks?
I think so.
You don't have any pain with it. But if you're having memory problems, you might want to see a doctor about how your heart's functioning.
Yeah. It's written. Go ahead.
There are two things that affect the brain function very much that I know of that affect the brain waves. One is prayer. It immensely amplifies your brain so much that I think it startles the demons that are around, because they can read it on instruments. The other thing is cell phone use, a very negative impact on brain.
That's right. Apoptosis. It's a real thing. want to maintain our full functioning brains. So if you pray for me, and I'll pray for all of you. Thank you.
Amen.
I guess we have a prayer or song service. I guess we'll have a prayer. Father in heaven, I thank you for this morning, and I know we each have our struggles, and I know I have mine. I pray that you'll forgive us where we have fallen short, where we have perhaps lost trust in you over certain periods of time. And we pray that you'll help each one of us to overcome, help us to not take our eyes off of you, Father. And there are many bodily propensities that can lead us. Depression is that many of us perhaps struggle with at certain times. We pray that you will help us to encourage one another and to love one another. I pray, and please bless this camp meeting. I pray in Jesus' name.
Amen.